Welcome to the channel Get Rich. Today the company we are going to look into is Deepak Nitrite Limited. This company is operating in chemical industry. So let's first have a look at global chemical industry. The global chemical industry currently stands at $4 trillion in annual sales. Over the past two decades, this industry has witnessed a structural shift of manufacturing dominance from the West, that is America and Europe, to the East, China, followed by rest of Southeast Asia. China alone represents a dominant 35% share of the global chemical industry, while India has only modestly benefited from the Easternization of chemical manufacturing. It is, however, expected to be one of the fastest growing chemical markets in the world in the coming years. India is said to be a key beneficiary of structural shift in the global supply chain. So then let's have a look at Indian chemical industry. So the chemical industry in India covers a wide array of more than 70,000 commercial products. India is the sixth largest producer of chemicals globally and third largest producer in Asia in terms of output. The country ranks third globally in the production of agrochemicals and contributes around 16% to the global dyestuff and dye intermediaries production. On the export front, India's share stands at 12.5%. And it ranks 14th in exports and 8th in imports of chemicals, excluding pharmaceutical products globally. The Indian chemical industry is expected to double to $300 billion by 2025, recording an annual growth rate of 50-20%. To achieve this, the government is working on a draft chemical policy that will focus on meeting the rising demand for chemicals and reduce imports. The government allows 100% FDI under the automatic route in the chemical sector, and this has and will keep improving FDI into the industry. The total FDI in chemicals excluding fertilizers from April 2000 to December 2019 stood at $17.4 billion. India ranks 8th globally in chemical imports and is a net importer. Despite the improving condition of the Indian chemical industry to grow and make a significant impact at a global level, many intermediates and value-added chemicals are still falling short of the required volumes. The Indian Chemical Councils aim to achieve a turnover of $300 billion by 2025, backed by government support in proposed infrastructure and policy changes. The investment requirement for this is estimated to be around $75 to $100 billion, and the primary objective is to reduce India's dependence on imports of chemicals. So if you have a look at structural growth drivers for India, India's largest population with rising disposable income, urbanization, growing investments in infrastructure and demand from rural markets are some of the fundamental factors driving growth of the consumption of end-use products, leading to growth in demand for the chemical industry in India. In addition, huge dependence on agriculture and strong demand for exports throws vast opportunities for chemical players based in India. Also, India has a low per capita consumption of chemicals as compared to the rest of the global economies. The per capita consumption of chemicals in the country is 1/10 of the world average, with India being one of the low consumption countries even among the developing nations. So the consumption pattern is expected to rise with the rising incomes of the population and consumers demanding better quality products, with shifting their preferences towards a healthier lifestyle and environmental friendly products. The shift in production and consumption pattern towards Asian and Southeast Asian countries in all sectors is leading to increasing demand for chemicals and petrochemicals. The combination of domestic consumption and export growth has made it viable to locate manufacturing operations in India, thereby enhancing India's contributions to the global chemical industry. India's chemical and petrochemical industry accounted for 3% of the global chemical industry in financial year 2018-19, and this is expected to further increase at accelerated rate. So then let's have a look at Deepak Nitrite Limited. So Deepak Nitrite Limited is ranked amongst Fortune Next 525 top wealth creators by the prestigious Fortune India magazine. Deepak Nitrite Limited today is one of India's fastest growing chemical intermediates companies, with a diversified business of basic chemicals, fine and specialty chemicals and performance products. Further, it manufactures phenol, acetone and isopropyl alcohol through its wholly owned subsidiary Deepak Phenolics Limited. So they are the top three global players for xylidines, cumarins and auxins. So they are the leading Indian producer of sodium nitrate. So they are serving clients in 30 plus countries. They started from a bulk commodity product manufacturer. Deepak Nitrate has evolved into a specialty chemical company operating in three key divisions, as I said before. Deepak Nitrate Limited has a number of credits to its name for manufacturing of chemicals. So as I said, it holds a leading position in products such as sodium nitrate, nitrotoluene. So they are the only company in India to have fully integrated OBA setup. They are the sole manufacturer for thermal paper chemical in India. The end-use applications of Deepak Nitrate Limited products vary from agrochemicals, dyes and pigments to pharmaceuticals, rubbers, chemicals, refinery, textiles and colorants. So their net revenue was 4,265 crores in March 2020. So they are the largest producer of phenol and acetone since 2018 in India. They have 6 manufacturing facilities. They are exporting to 30 countries in 6 continents. They have 1000 plus consumers and they are the leading producer in inorganic salts, salidines, cumarins, toluidines, phenolics and IPA. Over the years, it has significantly expanded its footprint in the export geographies of Europe, America, Japan, Latin America, Southeast and Far East Asia. Overall, it exports to more than 30 countries. On the domestic front, it has been an undisputed leader with cost leadership across key products. So Deepak Nitrate is favorably positioned to capture opportunities across the chemicals and specialty chemicals landscapes. As the operation cost for China, world's largest supplier, increased due to focus on sustainable manufacturing, it will result in an increase in the landed cost of chemicals. Improving the competitiveness of alternate suppliers, it will open up opportunities for established players such as Deepak Nitrate. Deepak Nitrate has product portfolio of basic chemicals, fine and specialty chemicals, performance products. They are the supplier of choice for Unilever, Bayer, Indian Oil, BASF, L'Oreal, Reliance Industries Limited. Look at the names. They have a very, very high profile customers. So if you are having a look at revenue breakdown, 42% of their revenues are coming from basic chemicals, 29% of their revenue are coming from fine and specialty chemicals, 29% of their revenues are coming from performance products. They are present in pharmaceuticals, agrochemicals, personal care, petrochemicals, dyes and pigments, paper, fuel additives, detergents, and they are also expanding into resins, adhesives, coatings, and also adult chemicals. Let's have a look at Deepak Phenolics, a wholly owned subsidiary of Deepak Nitrate Limited. So to address the opportunity in the domestic market for phenol and acetone, which is currently met by imports, Deepak Nitrate has undertaken a greenfield project at Dahej, Gujarat. Deepak Phenolics, Deepak Nitrate's 100% subsidiary company, already commenced with production in the last quarter. This plant, with an investment of 1700 crores, is based on cutting edge technology and IoT enabled, will be best in class resource and energy efficient in the industry. So the capital expenditure is being funded by debt and equity in the ratio of 60:40. So this is one of the biggest private sector investment in recent times in India. Let's have a look at their share of revenues over the years. So if you have a look at financial 18, 49.5% of their revenues are coming from basic chemicals and 19.9% from performance chemicals and 30.7% from fine and specialty chemicals. And then if you have a look at financial 19 and financial 20, almost 53.3% are coming from phenol and acetone in financial 2020 and then 13.7% from fine and specialty chemicals, 10.4% from performance chemicals and 22.5% from basic chemicals. So they have built a big manufacturing plant for phenol and acetone. So then if you are having a look at their product summary, so the basic chemicals, their main products are sodium nitrate, nitrotoluidines, fuel additives, nitrosyl sulfuric acid, and their applications are in colorants, petrochemicals and rubber. If you look at fine and specialty chemicals, it's salidines, oximes, cumarins, specialty agrochemicals. So their application are present in agrochemicals, colors and pigments, paper, personal care, pharmaceuticals. If you are then having a look at performance products, it's optical brightening agent, OBA and DASTA. So their application is paper, detergents, textiles, coating applications in printing and photographic paper. And then if you are having a look at phenolics, it's phenol, acetone, cumene and isopropyl alcohol. Their application is in laminate and plywood, pharmaceuticals, adhesives, sanitizers, rubber, chemicals and paints. And then if you are having a look at their customers, they are all high profile customers. If you are having a look at their customers, it's Eastman, HP, Henkel, Sudarshan, Atul, Reliance Industries, Bharat Petroleum, Indian Oil, L'Oreal, Clariant, Model, or Trident, JK Paper, and so on. They have a lot of high profile customers. Let's have a look at the first segment, which is basic chemicals. 42% of their total revenues are coming from basic chemicals in financial 2019. So basic chemicals find application in dyes and pigments, pharmaceuticals, agrochemicals, concrete mixture, water treatment, rubber, heat treatment, glass industries, industrial explosives and fuel additives. The company will continue to swiftly capitalize on opportunities by diversifying capacity towards products that enjoy better demand scenario and will leverage its cost leadership position to drive market share gains. They manufacture nitrides, nitrotoluidines and fuel additives. Possessing cost leadership is one of the foremost competitive advantages required to drive growth and profitability, as most of these chemicals are sold in high volumes with greater price sensitivity. These chemicals are typically manufactured in standard specification and are subject to availability and pricing of raw materials. So their applications are mainly colorants, petrochemicals and rubber. And then if you are having a look at the growth, so the basic chemicals reported sales of 940 crores in financial 2019-20, growing by 5%. So it was estimated to grow at a higher rate of 8% in the coming year. And also if you are having a look at EBIT margin, their EBIT margin are increasing. So in the recent quarters, so their basic chemicals EBITDA margin is also increasing to higher 20s. So that's a very, very good thing. The question is whether they can sustain these kind of margins or not, but the management said they can sustain these kind of margins. Also, capacity expansion, introduction of value added products such as melanone nitrile, adenine and PMA will aid revenues from bulk chemicals. Revenue is expected to grow at a CAGR of 8% to 1135 crores by financial year 2022. If you are then having a look at the process for basic chemicals, it starts from ammonia, and they also have a lot of bulk chemicals and some of the fine specialty chemicals, and they are also having some new products in this process. So then if you are having a look at customers specifically for basic chemicals, it's Sudarshan, Atul, Henkel, Reliance Industries Limited, Bharat Petroleum, HP. They also have a lot of high profile customers in this segment as well. And then the second one is fine and specialty chemicals. 29% of their total revenues are coming from fine and specialty chemicals in financial 2019. Their main products are celadines, auxins, cumarins, specialty agrochemicals. So the fine and specialty business segment produces specialized and niche components from various processes and requires technical skills and technological competencies in handling potential complex reactions. These chemical intermediaries find application in agrochemicals, pigments, pharmaceuticals and personal care segments. The company witnessed increased demand for key products in the export markets, which also led to solid realization gains. Performance was also bolstered by benefits occurring from backward integration initiatives and capacity expansion for established products. Their main applications are agrochemicals, paper, personal care, pharmaceuticals. If you are having a look at the growth, fine and specialty chemicals segment revenue grew by 9% to 585 crores in financial 2019-20. EBIT for this segment grew by 33%. With strong product portfolio, the company is on track to deliver stellar performance in the FSC segment in the coming years. So already they are growing at a rate of 13%, so it is projected to be they are growing at 11%. And also the EBIT margin for fine and specialty chemicals is also doing very good. They have a very high EBIT margin as well. So Deepak Nitrate Limited is the sole manufacturer for thermal paper chemical in India. FSC is currently operating at 90% utilization levels. The company has pegged capital expenditure of 200 to 250 crore for financial 22 towards capacity expansion across bulk chemicals and FSC segment. So newer capacities coupled with development of toluene chain derivatives such as BDC and BTF and strong growth in end-use agrochemicals industry, it is likely to help the fine and specialty segment grow at a CAGR of 11% to 738 crore over the forecast period. So then if you want to have a look at the process chart for fine and specialty chemicals, they use xylene, oxylene, cumene and toluene as a base, and then they develop a lot of fine and specialty chemicals, and they also having some new products are going to be launched from this segment as well. And then some of the customers are L'Oreal, BASF, Clariant, Henkel, Bayer. So they have, like as I said, they have a lot of high profile customers. If you are having a look at performance products, 29% of their revenues are coming from performance products in financial 2019. So Deepak Nitrate is a leading fully integrated manufacturer of OBA, which is backward integrated from basic building block up to the feedstock of toluene to PNT and further into DASTA and OBA. These products have strict requirements in terms of performance and technical specifications. Over the years, The company has targeted and built a robust global customer network and has taken conscious efforts to place its products in the right geography. The performance product segment finds applications in paper, detergents, and textiles with its key value in the characteristics of the main product. The company efforts of reorienting its industry and geographical mix to ensure better product acceptance played a major role in driving the performance. Further, Deepak Nitrate's position as a fully integrated supplier of OBA has strengthened its competitive edge. During the year under review, they witnessed healthy realization gains in DASTA, which bolstered their overall performance in the performance product segment. Performance product segment reported a stellar during the year under review, growing robustly by 91%, translating to revenues of 768 crores. EBITDA also recorded solid growth of 403%. So their EBITDA margin went so high in last quarter because of the demand they have, and then the price explosion happened, and then it is expected to normalize in the coming quarter. The performance products division majorly consists of two products: optical brightening agents, where the company enjoys 75% market share in India, and diamino stilbene disulfuric acid DASTA with market share of 60% in India and 20% globally. Deepak Nitrate Limited is the only fully integrated manufacturer of OBA with vertical integration from toluene to para nitro toluene and further into DASTA and OBA. Key application area for OBA are detergents, paper, and textile. Adequate capacities and sustainable margins could help the performance divisions to grow at a CAGR of 12% to 570 crores. Increasing capacity of DASTA will ensure the same. And then if you are having a look at customers of performance products, it's JK Paper, TNPL, Sappi, Imami, Trident. So they have a lot of high profile customers in this segment as well. And then let's have a look at Deepak Phenolics. So Deepak Phenolics Limited, a wholly owned subsidiary of Deepak Nitrate Limited, began commercial productions at its mega phenol and acetone facility in Dak, Gujarat in November 2018. The facility has an installed capacity of 200,000 to manufacture phenol and 120,000 to manufacture acetone. It also has facility to produce 260,000 of cumin for captive consumption. The objective of foraying into these products was to substitute imports and parallelly grow the domestic demand. The company has already established itself as the most reliable player for phenol and acetone in the domestic market, with its market share touching almost 65%. During the financial year under review, the company was successfully able to substitute majority of imports. It was able to operate its manufacturing capacity close to above 90% utilization levels on a sustained basis. In line with its objective of moving into value-added downstream products with competitive raw material consumption, in April 2020, Deepak Phenolics Limited commenced commercial production of isopropyl alcohol. IPA is a solvent primarily used by pharmaceutical companies and is also used for manufacturing sanitizers. The plant has a production capacity of 30,000 annually, which is expected to serve humanity at the time of crisis when the world is combating COVID-19 pandemic, since IPA enables supply of sanitizers. And of course, this marks the first step towards the vision of establishing a basket of downstream derivatives of phenol and acetone. So it will continue to explore such products in the future to drive business momentum and focus on profitability. If you are having a look at some of the downstream products they can come up with, so you can see bisphenol A, isophoron. There are a lot of chemicals which are listed here, and their applications are used in epoxy resins, printing, disinfectant, fertilizer, pesticides, packaging, clothing, carpets, nylon, film, paints, coatings, rubber solvent, adhesives, automobile, construction, electronics. They have a wide range of applications for these downstream products. During financial year 2019 to 20, Deepak Phenolics Limited reported 2010 crores of revenues with 67 crores of profit after tax at 90% utilization capacity. The plant is expected to clock a revenue of 2538 crores by financial year 2022. Also, if you are having a look at the process of Deepak Phenolics, so you also see they have a product of phenol and acetone. They can also have come up with some downstream products which can be used in several applications. And then if you are having a look at the manufacturing facilities, so they have a manufacturing facilities in Nandasari, the first and flagship manufacturing facility, inorganic and organic chemicals and agrochemicals, and they have one in Roha, so intermediates for agrochemicals, dyes, fine and specialty chemicals, and Taloja. హెచ్గా సింథటిక్ ఆర్గానిక్ కెమికల్స్ ఫైన్ అండ్ స్పెషాలిటీ కెమికల్స్ అండ్ హైదరాబాద్ డై ఇంటర్మీడియట్స్ దహేజ్ బేసిక్ కెమికల్స్ ఫైన్ అండ్ స్పెషాలిటీ కెమికల్స్ పర్ఫార్మెన్స్ ప్రొడక్ట్స్ ఫినాల్ అండ్ అసిటోన్ ఫుల్ ఆటోమేటిక్ బ్యాచ్ ప్రాసెస్. So if you are then having a look at the location of these facilities, so they are located in Gujarat, Maharashtra and Telangana. In Nandesari, Gujarat, they have bulk and commodity product manufacturing with on-site nitration and specialty agrochemicals. In Dahej, they have full spectrum of optical brightening agents production. And in Maharashtra, Taloja, they have like hydrogenation and noble metal catalysis specialty. And then in Roha, Maharashtra, multi-specialty manufacturing facility specializing in pilot plants and scaling up activities, nitration and specialty agrochemicals. And in Hyderabad, they are manufacturing DASDA for captive use and for commercial sales. If you are having a look at domestic and export, in quarter 1 financial 2019, it was 63% domestic and 37% export, and it already improved to 51% domestic and 49% export in quarter 4 financial 2020. So the export increased from 37% in quarter 1 financial 2019 to 49% in quarter 4 financial 2020. So they are having increasing exports, which is a good thing, which has a higher margin. If you are having a look at where are their export are in financial 2018 to 19, 57% are to Europe and 14% US, 21% Asia and 8% others. If you are having a look at financial 2019 and 18, 45% Europe, 41% Asia including Middle East, 7% US and others are 7%. So then if you are having a look at revenue mix by application in financial 2018 to 19, so the colorants has 58%. It improved to 62% in financial 2019 to 18. Agrochemicals 26%, and it reduced to 22% in financial 2019 to 20. And fuel is 10%, which reduced to 9% in financial 2019 to 20. And pharma it's 3% to 4% in financial 2019 to 20, and others are remained the same at 3%. And then if you are having a look at the growth opportunities, Deepak Nitrate Limited acquired several land parcels as a part of its capacity expansion and growth plan. This comprises a big parcel of land acquired at Dahej, Gujarat, followed by small parcels of land acquired in Hyderabad and in Roha. The land acquired during financial 2019-20 has been capitalized, wherein the company had paid 141 crores in aggregate for these land parcels. If you are having a look at their new plant, phenol and acetone, so they can come up with lot of downstream products which finds applications in epoxy resins, packaging, textile, automobile, construction, electronics, paints and agrochemicals. They are also having IPA which are finding applications in sanitizers. So they are having a lot of growth opportunities going ahead. And then if you are having a look at their financials, so in March 2015, they have a sales of 1327 crores. It increased to 4230 crores in March 2020. If you are having a look at net profit, it increased from 53 crores in March 2015 to 611 crores in March 2020. Look at the growth. So they are growing pretty huge. So if you are having a look at their operating margin, it is 10% in March 2015. It already increased to 24% in March 2020. So they are operating at a very huge margin. So that is, I think it's because of their main product DASDA had a huge price explosion, and the management are confident of maintaining these kind of margins going ahead. But then I feel the margins will subside a bit. So then if you're having a look at their revenues, so between the base business and phenolics in financial 2019, it's 1792 crores from base business and 908 crores from phenolics. In financial 2020, it's 2229 crores from base business and already 2000 crores from phenolics. And then if you are having a look at their EBITDA margin and PAT margin, their EBITDA margin is increasing. So it already increased to higher 22% or 24% in financial year 2020. So going ahead, it can either sustain or the margins will subside a bit according to me. So the PAT margin, which is also increasing. If you are having a look at EBIT margin of different segments, their basic chemicals, they are doing fine. Their margins are going in an uptrend, so they are doing very well. And then if you are having a look at their FSC segment, their margins is also going up. And then if you are having a look at performance products, it was peaked at around quarter one financial 20 or around quarter three or quarter four financial 20. It has a very high price explosion, and now the price are remaining moderate. And then if you are having a look at Deepak Phenolics Limited, so their margin is stepping up, so it's in a high increasing trend, uptrend. So I feel they can sustain this total margin which they have currently. If you are having a look at the balance sheet, So their total asset increased from 1,125 crores in March 2015 to 3,217 crores in March 2020. If you are having a look at their borrowings, it increased from 545 crores in 1,107 crores. So if you are having a look at their return ratios, their return on equity, it's reduced to 10% in financial 2019. So currently it stands at around 20 to 25%. So their return on equity is quite good. Also, if you are having a look at return on capital employed, it is also around 20 to 25%. So that's pretty good. And then if you are having a look at the debt to equity, so it's almost less than one. So that's good because they made a huge investment in the new plant. So their Phenolics plant. So also if you are having a look at debt to EBITDA, it was also in the decreasing trend, and their interest coverage ratio, it's also in the increasing trend. So then if you are having a look at their cash flow, they have a quite good cash from operations, and it is estimated to have a quite good free cash flow in the coming years. Let's have a look at their shareholding pattern. So the promoter holds around 45.7%, and if you are having a look at the historical promoter holding, it increased from 44.6% to 45.7%. If you are having a look at FIA holding, it also increased from 10.4% in June 2018 to 11.5% in June 2020. If you are having a look at DIA holding, it decreased from 13.1% to 12.7% in June 2020. So it dropped from 15.3% in March 2020 to 12.7% in June 2020. So that's not a good sign. And then if you are having a look at the mutual fund shareholding changes, so the constantly the domestic mutual funds, they sold the shares. So it decreased from 30 million shares to 25 million shares. So a lot of mutual funds sold during this period from October 2019 to July 2020. So then if you're having a look at top shareholders from mutual funds, Nippon India Small Cap holds around 5.28% of 8,321 crores of their AUM. Franklin India Smaller Companies, they hold around 6.5% of their AUM. L&T India Value 2.23%, SBI Magnum Multicap 1.48%, also L&T Emerging Business Fund, IDFC, L&T Mid Cap, Aditya Birla Pure Value, IDFC Tax Advantage, Aditya Birla Small Cap Fund, IDFC, L&T, and many more mutual funds are holding this company. So then let's have a look at the valuation. So if you are having a look at the price chart of Deepak Nitrite Limited, they had a quite good rally in the recent months. So they are currently standing at around 750 rupees. So let's have a look at the revenue projections and also the valuation. So then if you are having a look at the revenues in financial 2016, it was around 1,373 crores. In financial 2017, it's 1,371 crores. Financial 2018, it's 1,651 crores. Financial 2019, it's 2,700 crores. Financial 2020, it's 4,230 crores. So I am projecting it to be 3,807 crores for financial 2021, and financial 2022, it's 4,568 crores. In financial 2023, it's 5,391 crores, with a revenue growth of -10% for financial 2021, 20% for financial 2022, 18% for financial year 2023. If you're having a look at net profit, it increased from 63 crores to 611 crores in financial 2020. So I am expecting it to be 514 crores for financial 2021, 617 crores for financial 2022, 755 crores for financial 2023, with a net profit growth of -16% for financial 2021, +20% for 2022, and 22% for financial 2023. So then if we calculate the price target with current valuation, which is PE of 16.6, so 1 year estimate would be 625 rupees, 2 year would be 751 rupees, 3 year would be 918 rupees, with the price cumulative growth of -22% for 1 year, -3% for 2 year, +17% for 3 year. This is because they had a quite nice rally in the recent months. I feel Deepak Nitrite Limited is a quite good company with a very good growth opportunity. So I am estimating price target with a PE of 22. So 1 year price target would be 829 rupees, 2 year price target would be 995 rupees, 3 year price target would be 1,217 rupees, with a price cumulative growth of 11% for 1 year, 34% for 2 years, 64% for 3 year. So this is not my recommendation, it is my personal opinion. So you have to do a due diligence before buying any stock. So if you'd ask me whether I will buy this stock or not, so I will not put my money in this stock at this point of time because it had a quite good rally. It might go up, but investors, if you have already invested in this stock, you are doing very good, and then you can continue to hold that stock. But then if you ask me to whether I will put fresh money into this company now or not, so I will not put my money in this point of time at the current price. If it had some kind of corrections, I might think of putting money in this company, but at the current price, I will not buy this stock. But then if you have a very, very long term in your mind, and if you believe in the industry and also in the company, you can buy this stock to have a decent return of 64% for 3 years. It might also even go up quite high. So this is not my recommendation. This is my personal opinion. You have to do your due diligence before buying this stock. So that's it for today. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, like, share and comment, and also subscribe this channel and click the little bell icon as well. So have a nice day. Bye-bye.